Good morning, everyone. I'm very excited to be here to share our perspectives on genomics for food and nutrition security. So, can I? Okay. So before we discuss about this thing, let me ask this question, why do we need to care for this topic? And I hope that you all had great breakfast today. Some of you may had paratha, some of you might had amritsari, kulche and chole. But if I ask the question that from where we get the chickpea from which you made the chole or wheat, I'm sure you are not going to tell me that you are getting this thing from supermarket. Of course, you can get these things from supermarket, but in the end, these are coming from the field through agriculture. And when you talk about agriculture, until 19th century, agriculture was very simple. You just increase the land area, you will have more produce. However, in context of the population growth, it took 200,000 years for the human history of the world population to reach 1 billion, and it took only 200 years more to reach 7 billion. In context of population, or in context of Asia especially, if you would like to see, in 1960s, India had about 450 million population. India was just growing 10 million metric ton wheats, and our population growth rate was about 2%. So India was at the edge of famine. Now, in that time period, Dr. Paul Ehrlich wrote a book, and I call it infamous book, called The Population Bomb. And the cover of the book says, while you are reading these words, four people will have died from the starvation, and many of them are children. In fact, he further mentioned, predicted in this book, that I don't see how India could possibly feed the 200 million people by 1980s. However, the good news is the prediction of Paul Ehrlich were found incorrect. Today, India is having 1.3 billion population. We are growing about 100 million metric ton wheat, about 120 million metric ton rice. India is right now the net exporter of wheat and rice, and we are self-sufficient in these crops. This has happened because of Green Revolution, where this state, Punjab, also played very important role. And these two scientists, Dr. Norman Borlaug and Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, they are considered as the architects of the Green Revolution. In fact, they say that these are the two people who saved and fed maximum number of the peoples on this planet. Now, I would like to tell one story about me. Way back from 2000 to 2005, when I was doing research in Germany on genomics aspect, at that time, I happened to attend a conference in 2003, and this was about from the Green Revolution to the Gene Revolution. I met Dr. Norman Borlaug there, and of course many other scientists, and then while talking about the food security, Dr. Norman Borlaug challenged the audience, mentioning, I challenge the next generation to use these new scientific tools and technology to address the problems that plague the world's poor. And these words inspired me, encouraged me a lot. After coming back from the conference, back to my lab in Germany, I started to read more about this topic. I read one paper from Food and Agricultural Organization, and also at the same time, way back in 2005, we had one genome sequence paper on the first crop species, that was rice. So based on the combination of the genome sequencing, breeding methodology, and food security, together with Professor Mark Sorrells from Cornell University, Professor Andreas Graner from IPK Gardner-Slevin, we gave a concept of genomics-assisted breeding, which has become very popular during the last 15 years. By using this concept, we have given an idea how we can use the modern science technology to enhance the crop productivity so that we can contribute towards the food security. Now, if we see the current scenario, even at present, we are having 800 million people who are not getting enough food. So this means one in the 10 people. And at the same time, we are having about 2 billion people who are having, who are suffering from the deficiency of one to more micronutrients in their diet. In the context of India, as I mentioned, that the good news is India is self-sufficient in the main cereal crops, wheat and rice, but still our plates are missing pulses, important source of the proteins, and the vegetables, which is important source of the micronutrients. If you see project or if you see about the future, we believe there is a predicted population of 9 billion. Question is, how we are going to feed this population? To feed 9 billion people, we need to increase food at least 70%. And challenge is big. This is going to be much more bigger because we need to produce more with the less resources, less water, less arable land, less favorable conditions. So in this aspect, if we ask a question, can genomics contribute towards ensuring food and nutrition security? My answer to this question is yes, definitely yes. Genomics and allied disciplines of crop improvement are playing, going to play much more important role in this direction. Before we go in the details, let's ask what is genome. So genome is basically a complete set of the genes or the genetic material of a cell or an organism. And genes are the segments of the DNA which are responsible for the traits. It is possible now to sequence the entire genome and also decode the genome information for any crop, for any organism. And we can decode this genome information. What does it mean? Let me ask a question. Have you ever wondered why Aishwarya Rai is having blue and green color eyes? And Priyanka Chopra and many others, they are having black and brown eyes. Of course, there are many genes which determine the eye color, but a single change in one gene called HERC2 is responsible or can lead to the blue color eyes. Not only in terms of the eyes, we all look different. Why? Let's see. Some people, they are born handsome like him, and some, they are like him with the big belly. And not only these two people, all of us, all the people on this planet, they look different. And this is just result of variation in your genome, and that's just 0.5% of the genome. Can you believe it? In the similar way, in the crops, for instance, chickpea or for wheat, you are having the maximum variation 1%, only 1%. And because of this 1% variation, some varieties become resistant or susceptible to one stress or other stress. So idea is we need to understand this genetic variation. We need to understand the basis of this, genetic basis of this trait. And then we can help enhancing crop productivity. At ICRISAT, we work on these five important crops, chickpea, pigeon pea, groundnut, pearl millet, and sorghum. And these crops, they are important source of the nutrition. However, the crop productivity of these crops is very low. When I joined ICRISAT way back in 2005, we did not have much genomic resources in these crops. They used to be called orphan crops. But these are important crops for the smallholder farmers. So what we did, that we at Center of Excellence in Genomics and Systems Biology at ICRISAT, in collaboration with different partners around the world, we sequenced the genomes of all these crops, chickpea, pigeon pea, groundnut, pearl millet, etc., which are important crop of ICRISAT. Not only this, we sequenced the genomes of several crops which are important in Asia. And when you sequence these crops, genomes, you have the genes in your hand. The gene number, they may vary from one crop to other crop. For instance, in the case of rice, you are having about 37,000 genes. In the case of chickpea, you got 28,000 genes. What we do, by using the genetic mapping approaches, we try to associate these genes with the different traits. And once this relationship is established between the gene and the trait, then we use these genes to select the better lines in the process of plant breeding, in the laboratory. You don't need to send these seeds to the field. So basically what I'm saying, that you do not need to sow the seeds, you don't need to wait for them to grow and to exhibit the traits. You can do these analysis in the laboratory. In this process is called genomics assisted breeding. And by using genomics assisted breeding, you can reduce the time for development of varieties up to half time. And what we have been doing at ICRISAT, in collaboration with different partners at ICRISAT and other organizations, have successfully used the genomics assisted breeding methods in development of superior varieties. I would like to highlight five examples. And one example is about chickpea. So this is when you are having the fusarium wilt attack in the chickpea, and fusarium wilt is a fungal disease. When this attacks chickpea, then you can have the yield loss from 15% to the severe yield losses. Here on the left hand side, Dr. Mannur, great chickpea breeder. He worked at University of Agricultural Sciences, Raichur in Karnataka. He's retired now. He developed one variety called Annigiri way back in 1978 when I was just 5 years old. But, and this variety was very popular, had great adoption in Karnataka and United Andhra Pradesh state. But in recent years, this variety became very susceptible. Yield has gone down, but farmers still love to grow these varieties. So we got concerned. Farmers are interested to grow the same variety. We got the less yield. And I should also tell that breeders, they love their variety in the same way as parents love their children. So Dr. Mannur got concerns. He and I had the discussion. Dr. Mannur asked this question to me, Rajeev, can you help me? Can genomics help in this particular case? Dr. Mannur and we worked together and we developed the improved version of Annigiri by using genomics method, genomics assisted breeding method. He evaluated these lines in his research plot in the farmer's field. On the right hand side, you are having a farmer from Karnataka state. Dr. Mannur got excited to see the resistance label and the yield in this super Annigiri variety. So, and in fact, I should tell that he was having these discussions a few years before his retirement. And when he developed this super Annigiri variety, after his retirement, he mentioned one day to me, Rajeev, I never ever saw the DNA in my life, but I was very happy, was very excited to see the DNA products in my field. So ladies and gentlemen, this is the power of the genomics, which does not just help in delivering the better varieties, but can make breeders also happy. The second example I would like to mention about development of Ascochyta blight resistance chickpea. When you have the susceptibility to Ascochyta blight, then you are having these varieties which are on your right hand side. You don't have anything. By using genomics assisted breeding method, in collaboration of Punjab Agricultural University Ludhiana, we developed the improved version of that line in that manner. And you can see now that you are having the pods, you will be having the yield. Third example, I would like to mention about the development of drought-tolerant chickpea varieties. Here, by using genomics assisted breeding method, we have developed lines with higher root volume, higher root land density, higher root biomass, so that the chickpea lines, they can extract more water from the ground. And when we have evaluated these lines at several locations in India, Ethiopia and Kenya, we found these lines are giving 10 to 24% higher yield. Third example, I would like to mention about development of foliar disease resistant lines in the case of groundnut. In collaboration with the University of Agricultural Sciences, Dharwad, and Directorate of Groundnut Research of Indian Council of Agriculture Research, by using genomics assisted breeding method, we have developed the improved version of TEDx24 variety. TEDx24 variety is drought tolerant but susceptible to foliar disease. Now, you can see very clear cut expression of the disease. That susceptible line, they are not growing well, and the resistant line, you are having wonderful yield. And we could have from 56% to 96% higher yield in these resistant varieties. Lastly, I would like to give an example related to the nutrition, and this is again about groundnut. If you see the groundnut oil, this is having basically three types of oils.
Linoleic acid is a polysaturated fatty acid, not good for health. But in groundnut oil, in general, we are having around 30% linoleic acid. Palmitic acid and oleic acid, they are monosaturated fatty acid. They are good for health, especially oleic acid. Groundnut varieties, they are having generally 30% linoleic acid. By using genomics assisted breeding method, we have changed the composition of the oil in this groundnut. And you can see on the right hand side, these green color bars, they are oleic acid. Now we got the varieties which are having more than 80% oleic acid and just about 10% or less than 10% linoleic acid. So now what we are doing, we are taking these disease resistance molecular breeding line and high oleic acid lines for evaluation in Africa, and we are evaluating them in several countries in Africa, including Mali, Nigeria, Ghana, Malawi, etc. On the left, on the right hand side, here is my collaborator, Dr. Richard Orton Frimpong, and he is coming from the Savannah Agriculture Research Institute from Ghana. He is showing his experimental feed material to me and my other colleague, Dr. Haile Desme, when we were visiting Ghana last year, and we were very excited to see the yield and the evaluation of these lines in these countries. So in summary, I would like to mention that genomics can play important role. Genomics can help in delivering better yielding, climate resilient, and nutritious varieties, and they can bring smiles to the farmers, consumers, and of course breeders and researchers. Thank you very much.